And people say that they see miracles every day. And then the world uses the term miracle fabric, miracle detergent, miracle drug, miracle cream. But God designed the laws of nature, and though they may be marvelous, if they're according to the laws of nature that he designed, they're not a miracle. He designed childbirth. So when a child is born the way he designed, that's not a miracle. But if that child was born in 3 days, that would be a miracle. I believe we understand what people mean sometimes, but when the preachers and the teachers from the pulpit convey it and use it and perpetuate it, then there's no surprise when people misunderstand. The working of miracles and then 1 Corinthians 12, the gifts of the Spirit, that which is against the laws of nature. A miracle is something that's contrary to the laws of nature. The Lord spoke to Brother Hagin one time when he was concerned and praying when the healing anointing that he has did not go into a child he was praying for. He was aware that there was no transfer of anointing, and he had compassion and actually fasted 3 days to know why the healing anointed did not go into this child. And the third day of the fast, the Spirit of God spoke to him and said, what you have won't work there. I gave you a healing anointing. And that child was born with something missing in her brain. And that would mean need a miracle. Something that's missing can't be healed. Someone that didn't have an arm, you wouldn't say, Lord, heal that person's arm. Someone that maybe a finger was cut off on the job and they're coming for prayer, you wouldn't say, Lord, heal that person's hand. Heal that person's finger. There's no finger there. To be healed, healing is the recovery of a sickness or a disease. Something that has to be regenerated, restored. The life has to be replaced. But if there's no finger there, there's no life to be replaced. There's no healing that is necessary. And so the Spirit of God spoke to him and said, I gave you a healing anointing. There's nothing there to heal. What that child needs is a working of miracles. Now you can pray and God can do a miracle. Gifts of the Spirit can operate through anyone. Usually doesn't, but can. And then two on earth can agree and you can receive a miracle just through the agreement. Well, the Spirit of God spoke to him and said, have that mother agree with you for a miracle. Her faith can receive a miracle. Well, why won't the Lord just do the gifts of the Spirit? Well, in Jesus' ministry, the gifts of the Spirit did not operate through everyone. At the pool of Bethesda, only one got healed that way. Did not operate to everyone through him. The gifts of the Spirit did not operate through Jesus. Most people healed under the ministry of Jesus in his earthly ministry before the resurrection were healed by the healing anointing. That was the primary way he ministered. Most people either touched him or he touched them and drew it out. And that comes by faith, and faith comes by hearing. And so he taught in his own hometown when he couldn't do a mighty work because of their unbelief. He taught. And the antidote for unbelief is teaching. Well, the gifts of the Spirit didn't operate. They wondered why. They asked him, you know, you're wondering why I'm not doing any miracles here that you heard about in Capernaum. So he gave two scriptures, Old Testament scriptures. That's all that he had. So he gave two Old Testament scriptures to explain to them why no one was receiving any mighty works. He couldn't do a mighty work. He could do some small things. He laid hands on a few with minor ailments, the Greek says. Well, he couldn't do a mighty work. It says that clearly. Laid his hands on a few sick folk and healed them. Well, the ones he healed didn't have much wrong. And this is Jesus, who couldn't do a mighty work. So Brother Hagin was fasting and praying about this child. And the Lord said, what I've given you won't work here. Now, ministers today just pray. Most ministers, I observe, they just lump it all together and we're just going to pray. But when you have something that's specific, you ought to preach it, you ought to teach it, and you ought to understand why things work and why things don't work. 1 Corinthians 12:28, God has set some in the church. Some in the church have anointings that others in the church don't have. Well, you ought to know. I mean, it's good when you know what you have and you can talk about it, teach it, preach it, explain it, and the faith of the people can rise to reach out and receive it. If you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you'll receive a prophet's reward. A righteous man in the name of a righteous man, you'll receive a righteous man's reward. Jesus preached it. The Spirit of the Lord's upon me. He's anointed me. He preached it. He taught it. And when people believed it, they received it. Well, Brother Hagin has the healing anointing. The Lord said to him in that vision, it won't work if you don't tell it. But when he tells it, what is going to work is what he has. And so he's asking the Lord, why couldn't I minister to this child? The healing anointing didn't flow. Why not? And the answer was the baby, that child was born with something missing in his head, in his brain, in her head. And what I've given you won't work here. Now, 1 Corinthians 12:28, God has set some in the church, first apostles, secondarily prophets, thirdly teachers, after that, miracles, then gifts of healings. Are all apostles, are all prophets, are all teachers, are all workers of miracles, have all the gifts of healings, helps, governments, diversities of tongues? Well, some are workers of miracles. Some have gifts of healings. But not all are all workers of miracles. Nay, anyone can pray, but some are especially anointed. Have all gifts of healings, and everyone can pray, but some are especially anointed. Brother Hagin didn't have the working of miracles as a ministry. On occasion, it would operate. I've had it operate on occasion through my ministry, but it's not a ministry gift in this ministry. A ministry gift will operate more often. I have a hammer, but I'm not a carpenter. I use my hammer, but a carpenter uses his more often. I may have the same hammer he has. I may have a better hammer than he has, but he would use his more often. Gifts of the Spirit can operate through anyone as the Spirit wills, but some are especially called in various offices. The Bible there in 1 Corinthians 12 refers to administrations and operations, gifts. Then it says all of them are manifestations. And then it also, the Bible refers to demonstrations of the Spirit. Well, those who have ministry gifts will operate more often. Those who have working of miracles will have miracles more often. Philip the evangelist in Acts chapter 8, they believed the things which he spake, both hearing and seeing the miracles which he did. For unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out of many that were possessed with them, and many taken with the palsy and that were lame were healed. And there was great joy in that city. Now, Philip is an evangelist. It says so later in the book of Acts. He's the only evangelist that we have other than Jesus. Philip's the only evangelist we have. And if you go by him, which you should, then every evangelist ought to have healings and miracles. Because you're taking the gospel of Jesus Christ to sinners, to the world, people who have not heard. And you'll have to have the confirmation. The apostle will have to have miracles. 2 Corinthians 12, verse 12 says, truly, the signs of an apostle were wrought among you with much patience, signs, wonders, and mighty deeds. The apostle will have to have miracles. The evangelist will have to have miracles and healings. But did you notice in Acts chapter 8, Philip the evangelist, the only thing that's mentioned there are people taken with the palsy and that were lame. Other than evil spirits crying with a loud voice came out. And that was right in the middle of the service. I mean, right in the middle of the service, unclean spirits cried out with a loud voice and came out. Right in the middle of the service. Now, when you're evangelistic and you're going into the world where people are not saved, you're among people who have evil spirits. They're not saved. And when you're preaching Jesus Christ, it ought to be the devil, the one that's getting nervous. When the devil manifests, it ought to be the devil getting nervous, not God's people. We may see some things that we don't understand or have never seen before, but we ought not be nervous. The devil should not be intimidating the church. The church should be intimidating the devil. And he's preaching Christ. It says later in Acts chapter 8, later verse 14. Now that's verse 5, but later in verse 14, it says they believe Philip preaching things concerning the kingdom of God and the name of Jesus. Verse 12. Verse 14 is the apostles came down to help him. The apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God. They sent Peter and John. When they'd come down, they'd prayed that they'd received the Holy Ghost. Philip didn't try to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. That's not his ministry. That's why we should work with one another. We need one another. No one has everything. The apostles, that's verse 14, that were at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had received the word of God. So they sent Peter and John to come work with and help Philip. Philip welcomed them, was glad to have them. Philip wasn't trying to get them filled with the Holy Ghost. That's not his calling. That's not his anointing. That's not his ministry. Now, a prophet would do that. A pastor would do that. The apostles could do that. But the evangelist may not even be interested in it. Now, he's filled with the Holy Ghost himself. And he knows it's important. He knows it's necessary. But that's not his ministry. That's not his anointing. That's not where he's going to focus. That's not what he's going to preach on. So he welcomes the help of others who have a different anointing. The apostles heard Samaria had received the word of God. Well, they sent Peter and John to help because Peter and John could bring a different anointing. Prayed with them that they'd received the Holy Ghost. For as yet he had fallen upon none of them, only they had been baptized in Jesus. And the Greek word in means in too. Also, well, verse 12, though, says that they believe Philip preaching. Well, what did he preach? In verse 5, it says he preached Christ. He preached Christ. He didn't preach on the devil, and yet the devil came out. You know, I find out from there you can preach on Christ and the devil will come out. You don't have to preach on the devil to get the devil out. I wish some so-called deliverance ministries would read that verse every day for 30 days and realize you don't have to preach on the devil to get the devil out. He preached Christ and unclean spirits crying with a loud voice came out. Well, verse 12 says he preached things concerning the kingdom of God. That's the dominion of God. That's the authority of God. That's God's presence now on the earth. And God is going to have some leadership and some rulership and some dominion and authority now. Because of the name of Jesus. And though we're in the world, we're not of the world. And there is a new kingdom, the kingdom of God. There is a new dominion, the dominion of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And when you preach the name and when you preach the kingdom, you should have people rise up with faith to receive victory because we're in him and we've been set free and we're above and not beneath. We're the head and not the tail. And the things of the Old Testament can be fulfilled. He said, I didn't come to destroy the law. I came to fulfill the law. And so now in Jesus Christ, we can reign in victory in him. So the dominion of the kingdom of God and the dominion of the name of Jesus, and he's preaching this. And while he's preaching, unclean spirits cry out with a loud voice. I mean, right in the middle of the service. I've had that. Not so often. I'm not an evangelist. I'm not in that place, but I've been there where while you're preaching, while you're praying, they just cry out. It might disturb some people around them. I had one lady, she ran out of the room. Found out later she had just watched The Exorcist on television that week. She ran out of the room. never came back. Her husband came back to other services. She never came to another service. Well, that's to be regretted. But right in the middle of the service, the devil was nervous. We ought to make the devil nervous. Well, what else happened? Those that were sick of the palsy and that were lame were healed. It does not say any blind eyes were opened. It does not say any deaf ears were opened. What it says, people sick of the palsy and that were lame were healed. Is that what it says? It doesn't say any deaf ears or blind eyes or anyone that was mute, dumb, deaf and dumb, mute, blind. Doesn't say anything about these people, but those that were sick of the palsy and lame. So even though he has gifts of healings, it's specialized. It may be called a gift of healing to minister to this particular sickness. And that's why it's plural in 1 Corinthians 12. God has set some of the church, those who have gifts of healings, and it's plural. In the Greek, it's plural each place you find it in that chapter. Both are plural. Gifts is plural. Healings is plural. I believe that's one reason why there's different sicknesses. Well, today where it's not taught, we just put it all, it's like we dump it in a bag, shake it up, and then dump it out. Come on, we're going to pray. God can do anything. Let's believe God. We're going to pray. But there are some who have special endowments and special endowments and special anointings. And if we would know what we have, we could focus on that, talk about it, teach it, preach it, let faith rise, and then minister with what we have. Now, when we don't have it, the Lord said to Brother Hagin in that moment where he had been fasting, the third day of the fast, he heard the Spirit of God speak. What I gave you won't work here. What I've given you won't work here. I've given you a special anointing to minister to the sick. A healing anointing is the recovery of sickness and disease. There's nothing there to recover. There's nothing there to restore. There's nothing there to rejuvenate. It's missing. That child was born with something missing in her brain. Well, what do I do then? Have that mother agree with you that it will be created, because she can still believe. All things are possible to him that believeth. If two on earth agree as touching anything that they ask, he still wants you to ask. Sometimes we say, let's agree. Will you agree? I'll agree. But there, if you read the whole verse and realize what's being said, he still wants you to ask. If two on earth agree as touching anything that they ask, it'll be done for them of my Father which is in heaven. So have that mother agree with you and ask for that which is missing to be formed. Well, what we can learn from this is Brother Hagin has something, but he doesn't have everything. And what he has won't work here. Well, if it won't work here, don't try to make it work. Not that. Get refocused. Something else will work. The prayer of agreement will work. The prayer of faith will work. Praying and believing will work. But the healing anointing won't work here. And so you pray for somebody and there's no flow. There's a reason why there's no flow. It won't work here. Sometimes people aren't drawing it out. Sometimes people don't make the connection and their faith isn't believing or receiving. But other times it won't work. And so a miracle is an intervention in what is the laws of nature, divine intervention, contrary to the laws of nature, where there's no finger there and it grows out. There's no hand there and it grows out. There's the axe head did swim in the old covenant, or Jesus broke the loaves and the fishes, the bread and the fishes, and multiplied, turned the water into wine. Where the person has no eyes, and he made clay of the spittle and put it in that man's eyes. I believe some translations even say that. Now, he's a blind man, but some even convey or infer that he didn't even have any eyeballs. And so eyeballs are formed. T.L. Osborne has told of experiences where he saw that happen. Someone had no eyeballs. The sockets were all that were there. No eyeballs. And he watched the eyeballs form. With his own eyes, he saw those eyeballs form. Well, he's doing the work of an evangelist. And he had miracles. I've seen several of his videos where you can see the miracles on, you know, he didn't get all of them videotaped and recorded. But he tells testimonies where there's nothing there and it's formed. It's not the recovery or healing, but it's a miracle. Well, that's what a miracle is, where it's contrary to the laws of nature. Amen. Now, the working of miracles, the evangelist is going into the world. They'll operate more often going into the world. The apostle is going into the world. In Romans chapter 15, Paul said, I preached not where Christ was named, lest I build upon another man's foundation. The best work of the apostle is going where Christ has not been named. That's why I believe that's why it says God has set some in the church first. When God is looking in an area of the world that needs to hear the gospel, he'll send first the apostle. They've never heard the gospel before. Who's necessary? What office is important? Who do I send first to this place that's never heard the gospel? The apostle. Well, the apostle will need to do miracles. He'll have to have signs, wonders, and mighty deeds, the way it's said in 2 Corinthians 12 and verse 12. Well, what about in the church? Well, we'll have miracles in the church. Gifts of the Spirit occur, and they will and they should. In Acts chapter 4, when they said, they prayed, stretch forth your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders would be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. They're praying for the gospel to be preached in the presence of opposition and persecution so they can take the gospel to people who have not heard it. And we're going to preach, give us boldness to preach your gospel, stretch forth your hand to heal. This is evangelistic. And it says later in that same chapter, in Acts chapter 4, that God answered that prayer around verse 23. Is it Acts 4, 23? Acts 4, 33. That they gave witness of the resurrection with great power. Well, they're telling people about the resurrection of Jesus. That's not saved people. You don't need to convince saved people that Jesus has been raised from the dead. They believe that already. Because you have to believe that to be born again. You confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has what? Raised him from the dead. But when you're taking the gospel to people who have never heard, you need to have some proof that he's been raised from the dead. And so Acts 4:33 talks about the witness of the resurrection with great power. We need the miracles that are referred to in the book of Acts happen most frequently, most often. The best application of miracles is taking the gospel to the world. When I'm taking the gospel to the world, I'll see miracles, should see miracles. And there are some who are miracle workers, especially the apostle and especially the evangelist. Now in the church, we'll have them, especially when new people come in. I have some things operate through my ministry with new people. And then after they're here for 3 or 4 months and a few more months, you know, and it doesn't happen anymore with them, but new people come in, it'll happen with the new people. Because God wants us to grow. He wants us to learn how to stand our ground. He wants us to learn how to have it believed that we walk by faith and not by sight. And don't go by what we see. And you'll have to learn how to stand your ground in these applications. So he wants the church to grow to where we believe we receive miracles and healings by faith. And then the gifts of the Spirit, the best application of the gifts of the Spirit are when they're in operation for the new people of the unlearned that are coming in or we're going to them. Amen. But the miracle is the intervention in the laws of nature when it's contrary to what was designed by God. It may seem miraculous. It may be marvelous. But if it's according to the design of God, the way he created it, then that would not be a miracle. It may seem miraculous, like the miracle of childbirth. Well, really, it's not a miracle because God designed it that way. But if that baby was born without something and you pray and it's created, that would be a miracle because that's against the laws of nature. Amen. Well, we misuse these terms. They're colloquial. Sometimes I know what people mean. When I hear somebody talk about a miracle drug, I know what they mean. It's not really a miracle. The Bible definition of a miracle and our definition of a miracle might be different. They talk about a miracle fabric. Well, it's not a miracle. It may be marvelous. It may be new. It may be, you know, beyond most understanding. But the miracle is when it's contrary to the laws of nature. It overrides, supersedes the laws of nature. That's a miracle. And there are some in the church who are workers of miracles. Turning the water to wine, that's a miracle. That would not be the ordinary, would it? Having 5 loaves and 2 fishes and feeding thousands of people, that's contrary to the laws of nature, isn't it? That's miraculous. I've had some experiences, and I've spoken to people and heard from people who've had some experiences where it's miraculous. It's contrary to the laws of nature. And God does that. And your faith can produce that and create that and receive that. But again, especially when we're taking the gospel to the world, we should expect them. And then when there are those who are especially called. Now, Philip, I don't know how he knew. I don't know if the Spirit of God gave him revelation or if he learned some things by experience. I don't know how he knew. But it doesn't seem to infer that he even ministered to anyone other than those who were sick of the palsy and lame. F.F. Bosworth would say somebody came to him one time and wanted prayer. And he, would you pray for me for a certain area? And he said, no. My wife is used more than I am along those lines. Go see her. And it was after some meetings in a convention. And people were standing around talking and fellowship. And he pointed and said, my wife is over there. Go see her. God uses her in that area more than me. But other ministers learned some things from F.F. Bosworth, his teaching, his preaching, and also his ministry. Nearly every person he would pray for that had anything wrong with their ears would be healed. And he would just sometimes, that's all he would call out. After he's preached, he'd call for a prayer line, a healing line. That's all he would ask for. If you have anything wrong with your ears, even if you've had an eardrum surgically removed, or if you were born without an eardrum, born deaf, or you've gone deaf or partially deaf, or even if you were born without an eardrum, or you had one diseased or had one removed, come up. And other ministers would watch, and he'd get, well, one minister said all of them. I've also heard nearly all of them healed. But it's just ear conditions. Well, God has set some in the church. And one thing listed there is gifts of healings. And then Philip, the only thing mentioned is those sick of the palsy and lame. So he got results with people sick of the palsy and lame. So I refer to that as a ministry gift. That is, it's a gift associated with his ministry. And somebody else may have a different ministry gift. That is a gift associated with that person's ministry, because God has set some in the church, and we don't all have the same endowments, giftings or abilities or unctions or anointings. We don't have the same gifts. Those who are in the ministry, especially the fivefold ministry, those who are called to function, there are operations, there are administrations, there are gifts. 1 Corinthians 12 refers to them as manifestations. Elsewhere in 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians, is it 1 Corinthians 2? 1 Corinthians 2, 4. 1 Corinthians 2, 4 refers to the demonstration of the Spirit. Is that right? Put that up. The demonstration of the Spirit and of power. So we've got demonstrations, administrations, operations, gifts, and their manifestations. Well, 1 Corinthians 12 says that all these worketh that one and the self same Spirit. It's the same Spirit. It might be a different gift, but it's the same Spirit. It might be a different operation. That is, it'll operate differently through this person than it does through that person. But it's the same Spirit. It might be a different administration, a different operation, a different gift, but it's the same Spirit. And so it's good when we know what we have. And we can focus there. I don't know how Philip knew it, but F.F. Bosworth, maybe by experience, monitor your own ministry. Just observe and see that you get more results in one area than you do another area. And over time, maybe, or through prayer or revelation, the Spirit of God speak to him. The Lord Jesus may appear and give some revelation where this is what I've called you to do. And so he realizes this is my calling, my anointing. So that's all he calls out. Anyone that has anything wrong with your ear. Well, now what we've done today in so many churches is we just lump it all together. Everybody come, we're going to pray. Well, sometimes really that's all you can do because you don't have time to teach. What is sad, though, is when if you had time, you still couldn't because you don't know yourself. It's good when you know what to teach or can teach, but if you don't have the time, then you just sometimes say, everybody come, and you know without saying out loud, you know not all of them are going to be healed because I don't have what they need. I haven't spent the time to teach to raise the level of faith. So many of them have already been taught wrong where they've been, but you still invite everybody to come in and pray. And then the gifts of the Spirit do operate. Sometimes you'll see some operations that you didn't even expect yourself because the gifts of the Spirit operate as the Spirit wills. But the healing anointing, if that's what I have and I can teach it and you believe it and receive it, it'll flow. If you receive a prophet in the name of a prophet, you'll receive what the prophet has. Well, in order to believe and to receive, you've got to hear about it somehow. That's why Jesus said to Brother Hagin, you've got to tell it. That's why he taught it and preached it. And when people believed it, it flowed. And so you tell people what you have. Well, if it's working of miracles, you can say, God uses me in this area. I've seen it. I've been around it. I've heard about it where the minister would say, God uses me in a particular area. And it would be miraculous, not a healing, but a miracle. And if you'd believe it, receive it, and to have him minister to you, reach out and take it, you'd see it in operation. Amen. Well, this is the work of God and the Spirit of God. I believe we ought to have more of these things. I believe we ought to pray for more of these things. I believe we ought to understand them. And then when we take the gospel to the world, I mean, these are glorious days. I think about the gospel going to the world. I think about North Korea. Father, thank you for your hand upon North Korea that you're raising up and have raised up people to go. Oh, it's even now in the unseen. It's behind what is seen. It's behind what is known. It's behind closed doors, as it were. But thank you for the gospel going forth in North Korea and that ministers go forth and shine as lights in the presence and in the midst of darkness, lifting up Jesus. And everywhere throughout the world and throughout the earth, your gospel is going forth with great power, with great glory, with people, men and women of God, raised up in power and glory and in might, going into the dark areas of the world to shine your glorious light. Thank you for the power of the gospel and the gospel with great might. Thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ being seen and known, and your goodness and your glory is shown. Thank you for the harvest and the fruit of the whole earth. We thank you for it. Stretch forth your hand to heal, and that signs and wonders would be done by the name of thy holy child Jesus. Let there be an increase of the manifestations of the Spirit, the gifts, the manifestations, the demonstrations, the operations. Let there be an increase of the revelation gifts, words of wisdom, words of knowledge, the discerning of spirits, an increase of the utterance gifts, that there would be prophecies by the Spirit of God, that there would be diverse kinds of tongues and the interpretation of tongues. Let there be an increase of the power gifts, those gifts that work and show the power of God, that there would be the gift of faith, special faith, working of miracles and gifts of healings, an increase of the manifestations of the Spirit for the glory of God and the blessing of mankind. For God, you so loved the world that you gave your only begotten Son, Son, and this gospel is going to be and is being preached, and the glory of the Lord is covering the earth as the waters do the sea. And we rejoice in the things of God. We rejoice in the things of God. We rejoice in the things of God being done in this day and in this hour. We rejoice and give you praise in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can you say amen, somebody? Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord forever. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. All right. Praise God.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord Hallelujah. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Ketatamanda dosetalabandiki. Non te kasapapahando. No yetete de kalata pati shando kataya. Loki dosetete la panda. Lotetia patete la paconde te samboria.
As you learn the things of God, as you learn the things that come by the word, then your faith will rise and you'll reach out and receive. For as you hear, you believe. And the things of God are then manifest, and great rejoicing is to be caused and be had by my people. And as you go forth with the testimony of Jesus, then others also hear, they also see, they also have the opportunity to believe and receive. And so the things of God of heaven are brought to this earth, and they come through the Lord Jesus Christ and the hearing of his word.
Yentunta la banda de la kita, losete de la banda de la bande, ye sombada de la baka, ye sanda.
And there is great praise and there's great glory that's lifted up from the earth to the heavens. For it comes from heaven to the earth and is returned again with praise and glory. And the praise and the glory coming from the heavens to the earth and then returned again bring great glory to God and in the presence of the throne of the Creator of all.
So rejoice! Candelala de Bote! Yendala de Baja! Yay! Holy yonder the la banda de la banda de la banda de la banda de la bocote.
So rejoice and let your praise be heard and seen and known. Rejoice and let the glory of God be shown. Rejoice and lift your voice and give praise to the name, praise to the name, praise to the name of the Lord Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Glory, 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 glory. Hallelujah. Well, my. Praise God forever. Thank you, Lord Jesus Christ. Can you say amen? Glory, glory, glory.